Hello friends, my name is JJ, and last week I asked you guys, my wonderfully international audience, to give me some good examples of iconic national photographs from your countries, and my god, did you guys ever deliver. I basically felt like this kid. So today, we are going to look at some of these photos, which I have determined, based on the number of comments they got, to be some of the most famous photos from around the world, as sorted by country. Before we get into the list, however, I just want to note that the fame of a photo does not necessarily correlate with the importance of what it depicts. So, for example, this photo of Marilyn Monroe is much more famous than this photo of Barack Obama on election night, even though I would hope that we can all agree that the election of America's first black president was more important than the 7-year itch. So just keep that fact in mind as we begin our tour of the world's most iconic national photos, as determined by you. Okay, so let us start with the nation of Great Britain, which, based on your comments, seems to have a pretty agreed-upon canon of iconic national photos. A lot of them involve World War II, which, as you will soon find, is going to be a bit of a reoccurring theme today. One that came up a lot was this grim photo of St. Paul's Cathedral, taken during the German bombing of London in 1940. Known as St. Paul Survives, it appeared on the front page of the New Year's Eve edition of the Daily Mail, where it was rather grandly proclaimed to be the war's greatest picture. According to my friend Solomon, it's tied quite heavily with the British sense of being knocked down during the war, but surviving despite the odds in true British fashion. A much more lighthearted pick, meanwhile, would be this photo of the Beatles crossing Abbey Road, which appeared on the album cover of the same name. Every year, thousands of tourists flood to the place where it was taken, on the literal Abbey Road, to recreate it, much to the delight of local traffic. And then we got this one, which was also cited by a great many Brits as a very heavily sentimentalized symbol of patriotic pride. It depicts Britain winning the 1966 World Cup, with the trophy being held aloft by team captain Bobby Moore. As my friend Samuel Lemon X18 says, it was massive because we won the cup, but also beating the Germans, who were the best at the time, not so long after World War II, was just unbelievable. My friend Deck Has Risen, however, also notes, as the photo ages, it takes on more EDL, BNP, FLA connotations, and is increasingly part of a major divide in British society. Those acronyms refer to various hard right groups in modern Britain, in case you were wondering. Moving on to mainland Europe, my German friends were all pretty unanimous in identifying this as one of the most iconic photos in their history, known as the Knee Fall. This is Willy Brandt, the first socialist chancellor of Germany after the war, on his knees before a memorial in Poland for the victims of the Warsaw Ghetto Uprising, which was, of course, one of the most infamous episodes in the history of the Holocaust. And this powerful image of a man occupying the same office as Adolf Hitler, prostrating himself before such a well-known symbol of Jewish suffering, well, this is how Brandt himself put it. At the abyss of German history and burdened by millions of murdered humans, I acted in the way of those whom language fails. My French friend, Nipal Mito, says that this photo, known as the Delegation of the Broken Faces at Versailles, is one that reliably appears in every French textbook. It shows five French soldiers who had been badly disfigured in World War I, who the French president had invited to the post-war peace negotiations in order to really bring home the magnitude of his country's suffering to the German participants. A much funnier one, meanwhile, that was brought up by basically all of my French friends is this very charming photo of Jacques Chirac, then mayor of Paris, jumping over a turnstile in a train station. He's not actually cheating the system because the train station was closed for some event, but he was still showing his savviness to this beloved French tradition. You can see that this French rapper even did a parody of it for his album cover. For Norway, a bunch of my Norwegian friends nominated this very interesting photo, which is known as the Royal Birch. It shows the country's king and his son seeking shelter from a German air raid under a birch tree during the 1940 invasion of Norway. Students of the war will know that the resilience of the Norwegian royal family in the face of the Nazis was a big story. And in Norway, this is the photo most commonly used to embody it. In fact, this photo is such a big deal in Norwegian culture that the tree in it has become the site of a national landmark, with these little commemorative plaques for where the royals stood and everything. You might have seen this famous photo from Sweden before, of a woman beating a neo-Nazi in the head with her purse, which was taken in 1985. My Swedish friends say it remains very popular, but also controversial, both because it glorifies violence and because, as my friend Guse puts it, the woman was mentally ill and hated the picture. An equally sensationalistic Swedish photo is this one, known as Dagen H, or basically Right Day. Swedes used to drive on the left side of the road, like the Brits, but in 1967 they abruptly changed to the right side, and this was apparently the result. My Finnish friends all cited this photo as their most iconic. It depicts Finnish soldiers raising a flag at the junction point between Sweden, Finland, and Norway. This picture was taken on April 27th, 1945. Which was the day that World War II ended for Finland. The Finns have this whole alternate timeline for World War II, based on their, shall we say, unique experiences with the war, but that is a topic for another day. This was the picture most often brought up for Italy. It shows a woman sticking her head through a newspaper with the headline, "The Birth of the Italian Republic." Italy voted to ditch its royal family and adopt a new constitution in 1946, in what is often seen as the true start of post-war Italian democracy, which is why the woman's sunny disposition makes this picture work so well as a piece of patriotic art. You may have even seen it framed in an Italian restaurant before. Much grimmer is this photo, which was also brought up a lot. This is Italian Prime Minister Aldo Moro, shortly before he was murdered in 1978. He was taken hostage by a group of radical communists, and this photograph, released by his captors, was obviously a very traumatizing image that has been seared into the Italian memory. For Greece, pretty much everybody brought up this 1973 picture of a tank storming into a school known as the Athens Polytechnic, where the students had been protesting the military junta that was running the country at the time. This is a very sentimentalized episode in the modern history of Greece, and to this day, all Greek students get November 17th off to honor the bravery of the Polytechnic protesters, like the ones seen in this picture. My Russian friends all more or less agreed that this was their most iconic national photo, the famed picture of Soviet troops raising their flag over the German parliament in Berlin, right at the end of the war. Photography experts might know this photo for another reason, which is that it was quite famously altered for propaganda reasons. Vox has made a whole video on this topic, which is quite interesting. This somewhat busy photo of Boris Yeltsin, the head of the Russian Soviet Republic, standing on a tank outside the Russian parliament, was also often cited as the photo Russians think of as embodying the end of the USSR. President Gorbachev had just been briefly overthrown by communist hardliners, and Yeltsin's rallying the Russian people from the back of this tank is often held up as a symbolic moment in which communism lost any lingering public support. It's almost a Renaissance type image, don't you think? Check out this guy. In Eastern Europe, meanwhile, their most iconic photos tend to involve standing up to the Russians in some way. This iconic Hungarian photo was taken at something known as the Blood in the Water water polo match between the USSR and Hungary during the 1956 Melbourne Olympics. As was so often the case with Olympic competitions during the Cold War, that game was seen as deeply symbolic of the political tensions of the time. In this case, the fact that the Hungarians had been on the receiving end of particularly brutal Soviet repression following a botched uprising just a few months earlier. And during the match, one of the Russians slugged one of the Hungarian players in the head, and this iconic image was born. But the guy in the photo himself wasn't too into this newfound reputation, according to this interview with him in Smithsonian Magazine. "I deeply regret that picture. I would have loved to be remembered as one of the best young players in the world, rather than the guy hit by the Russian." Okay, so here is how my Polish friend Krzysztof describes this next photo. This one is from the People's Republic of Poland after the introduction of martial law on December 13th, 1981, when the government wanted to shut down the opposition movement Solidarity. The tanks on the street and police curfew were part of daily life for almost 2 years. This photo is iconic because the movie Apocalypse Now is being shown in the cinema, which is truly ironic and scary. A number of my Polish friends also cited this very striking picture from 1987. It depicts the Polish doctor Zbigniew Religa shortly after he performed an agonizing 23-hour heart transplant operation on this guy. It is a very powerful image of Polish perseverance in the face of the limited resources of what was still quite a poor country, as evidenced by all of the little details in the operating room. Speaking of gore, a number of my Brazilian friends brought up a famous photo of the body of a guy named Vladimir Herzog. He was a journalist who was tortured to death by that country's military dictatorship in 1975, only for it to be covered up and declared a suicide. I won't show the photo because I know YouTube has rules against this sort of thing, but it shows him hanging by a belt that is like tied to this kind of very low-level grate thing on the wall behind him, and he's sort of collapsed on his knees in this kind of awkward-looking way. And the point is that this photo apparently looked very obviously fake to a lot of Brazilians, which just threw the military government into further public disrepute, particularly given just how many Brazilian journalists had been committing suicide recently. Another very striking picture from Brazil's dictatorship years was this one of police officers chasing a student. But my friend Philippe tells me that enough time has passed that people are starting to have some fun with it, as in this recent COVID-themed parody in a Brazilian political magazine. In Chile, you may have seen this famous picture of their longtime dictator Augusto Pinochet shortly after he seized power in a violent coup on September 11th, 1973. But a more recent photo a lot of my Chilean friends mentioned was this very dramatic picture of a Chilean man standing amid the rubble of his home that was destroyed in the country's terrible earthquake of 2010. Much of modern Mexican history begins with the revolutionary period of the 1910s and 20s, with this identified as the most iconic photograph of it. It shows Mexico's two most famous revolutionaries, Pancho Villa and Emiliano Zapata, sitting together in the presidential palace following the collapse of the national government in 1914. My friend Uriel says, being the only time these two iconic figures ever met, it represents the very peak of the Mexican Revolution. This image also depicts one of the few times the true purpose of the Mexican Revolution, that of peasants overthrowing the political elite, was actually achieved. It's been a while since we've seen a sports photo, eh? How about this one from Argentina, showing the hand of God? Here is how my friend Juan Nieto describes it. It was a goal scored against England during the 1986 World Cup quarterfinals that Argentina would later end up winning. Diego Maradona, considered by many the greatest footballer of all time, scored the goal, and he did it with his hand. The referees didn't notice it, and the goal stood. After the loss of the Falklands War in 1982, this was considered by many Argentines as something of a revenge against the English. I'm certain that everyone in Argentina recognizes this photograph. All right, now let's go to Asia. My many friends from India had no shortage of nominees for their country's most iconic photos, and they seem to be in broad general agreement. Everyone seems to agree, for instance, that this photo of Gandhi is the most iconic one of him ever taken. It shows him leading what was known as the Salt March of 1930, which was a long march against the coast of eastern India in protest of the high taxes the British colonial government had imposed on salt. It's one of Gandhi's most famous acts of civil disobedience, and this particular photo of it is so popular, they even built a statue of it in New Delhi. There were two iconic Israel photos that basically everyone brought up. The first is this one of soldiers raising the Israeli flag in the aftermath of the Israeli War of Independence in 1949. The fun fact that all Israeli school children learn about this photo is that the flag was actually just a crude homemade thing made from a medical blanket colored with the ink of ballpoint pens, making the ink flag a beloved national icon unto itself. The second photo was this 1967 shot of paratroopers at the Western Wall, a very holy site for the Jewish people that was obtained from Jordan in the so-called Six-Day War. My friend Mechanic Shark informs me that the men from this photo recently got together and recreated it in quite a wholesome fashion. Interestingly enough, however, the photographer behind this photo really hates it and considers it the worst of his professional career. From a photographic perspective, it's a bad picture. A good photograph includes no unnecessary elements. But here, there are all kinds of people in the background, half a head here, a quarter of a nose there. It's an important photograph, but not a good one. And since we've been talking so much about heavy political stuff, I just thought I would share this photo from Egypt, which my friend Brimba says is one of their most iconic ones. It's just a charming picture of jazz great Louis Armstrong playing for his wife amid the country's most famous landmarks. Turkey has a very famous patriotic photo that looks like this. It's been very widely sentimentalized, recreated, and satirized over the years. It shows a group of folks celebrating Turkey's Independence Day back in 1933. With a banner that says, "This is how we won the Republic." And of course, the implication is that Turkey is a strong country when everyone works together, as we see from all these different types of Turks in their various ethnic clothes and whatnot. It's an interesting picture because I think folks in America or Canada or places like that often think of this sort of proud multiculturalism as being very much their thing. But of course, many other countries of the world have a long history of celebrating their diversity as well. Moving down to South Africa, my friends there all cited this one very grim photo from 1976 showing the aftermath of a student protest against the apartheid government in a town called Soweto. I don't want to show this one either because it also has a dead body in it, but it depicts a man carrying a boy named Hector Peterson who had just been shot by the police. I guess I could show this picture of Barack Obama looking at it in a museum with the boy's sister during his visit to the country in 2006. The point is, it was such a vivid photo of wanton cruelty that it really helped galvanize the world against apartheid, as Time magazine put it. Okay, so in the Philippines, one of their most iconic photographs might be recognizable to Americans, as it depicts the great American general Douglas MacArthur tromping through the water as he arrives as part of the American liberation of the Philippines from the Japanese in 1944. They made a cool statue of this scene in 1981 that's permanently situated in a little pool of water right near the beach where it was taken. According to a number of my Indonesian friends, a very iconic photo in that country is this picture of a guy called General Sutomo giving a radio speech during the beginnings of the Indonesian War of Independence. As my Indonesian friend John puts it, a red and white horizontally striped umbrella shades him with its motif, intentionally or otherwise, mimicking the Indonesian flag, vividly and proudly radiating outwards, almost akin to a national halo, escorting the radio waves that carried Sutomo's words throughout the archipelago. It seems to be a pretty widely reproduced and parodied photo in Indonesia today. And lastly, in good old Australia, a number of my friends were quick to point out this photo of Prime Minister Gough Whitlam giving some sand to an indigenous leader named Vincent Lingiari. So Gough Whitlam was Australia's great post-war progressive leader who, amongst other things, began the modern process of honoring treaty and land rights for the native Australians. In 1975, he traveled to North Australia to formally resolve a land dispute with the Gurindji people. And this is what went down, according to the Australian Broadcasting Corporation. The Prime Minister comes forward. He makes a short speech about giving back ownership of the land. He then bends down and picks up a handful of sand and pours it into Vincent's hand, saying that it is a sign of the restoration of the land to his people. Vincent looks quite overcome and hangs his head, looking down at the sand. There is long silence. Even the kids are quiet. Finally, he says, "We are all right now. We are friendly. We are mates." And on that note, I am sorry to say we must bring this little tour of the world to a close. I apologize profusely if I didn't include your photograph suggestion or even your country in this video. There were honestly just so many good submissions that I literally could have spoken for hours about all of them. But rest assured, I did read all of your comments and I did look at all of the photos, and maybe sometime in the future we can think of something to do with the rest of them. But until then, I will see you next week.